The Angolan border war took place in the area of Southern Angola between South African Defence Force and the People's Liberation Army of Namibia, the military wing of Southwest African People's Organization, or SWAPO. This war lasted for 23 years between 1966 and 1989. Angola's civil war between the MPLA and the UNITA movements took place between 1975 and 2002. Between 1980 and 1989, the war escalated and reached a climax when the South African Defense Force and the UNITA rebel movement fought against Angola's FNLA military, which was backed by Cuban and Soviet Union forces in 1987 at the places in the area of Mavinga and Kitu-Kunavali in southeast Angola. The Angolan border war consisted of six stages. The Angolan border war consisted of six stages. The first part of a war. It was a low-intensity conflict without military involvement between 1966 and 1975 in the northern parts of Southwest Africa. The second part of a war. It was when the liberation movements in Angola competed for power, when Angola became an independent African state in 1975. During Operation Savannah, the South Africans moved more than 3,000 kilometers inside southern and western Angola to reach an area to the south of Luanga. After the operation was completed, the South Africans withdrew to their bases in Southwest Africa. The third phase of a war. It included cross-border operations in the shallow central area of southern Angola between 1976 and 1980, which consisted of important operations such as Operation Cropdave in 1977, Operation Reindeer in 1978, a revenge attack by SWAPO at a South African base at Katima Mulelu in the Caprivi in 1978, and Operation Triu Triu at Savati in 1980. The fourth part of a war. It consisted of cross-border operations in the deep central area of southern Angola between 1980 and 1983. The South Africans introduced mobile warfare by brigade strong mechanized infantry units. These operations, which were aimed at stopping SWAPO from entering into Southwest Africa and Angola, included Operation Skeptic in 1980, Operation Protea and Operation Daisy in 1981, Operation Super in 1982, which took place in southwestern Angola, Operation Meerbos in 1982, Operation Dolphin in 1983, and Operation Askari in 1983. The Angolas then agreed to a ceasefire which lasted during 1984 and parts of 1985. The fifth part of the war. It consisted of covert guerrilla warfare between 1984 and 1985, where clandestine operations took place in the area east of Kuvalai in the deep area in southern Angola while the Joint Monitoring Commission was in progress. 3-2 Battalion was involved in Operation Forte in 1984. The sixth part of the war. While South Africa was launching more attacks on SWAPO bases in the deep area of central southern Angola, Angola's FAPLA or FAPLA army advanced towards the areas that was held by UNITA in the southeastern part of Angola, where semi-conventional battles took place during the period 1985 to 1988. These operations consisted of Operation Egret in 1985, Operations Seven Cross and Alpha Centauri, both in 1986. During 1987 to 1988, the largest land battles on the African continent since World War II took place at the Lomba River in southeastern Angola during Operation Modula in 1987. During 1988, Operation Hooper and Operation Packer in the Tumpu areas 1, 2 and 3 took place near Kutu Konaval, which is an Angolan village on the western bank of the fast-flowing Kutu River. In the southwestern area of Angola, the final operations of the war took place at Techipa in 1988. After a peace treaty was approved on 22 December 1988, the South Africans withdrew from Southwest Africa and Cuba and its forces withdrew from Angola. Namibia became independent in 1989.
And their souls have fled in fight. Die Suid-Afrikaanse Weermag het aangekondig dat hulle uit Suid-Angola onttrek het na 'n suksesvolle operasie waar tydens 'n belangrike terroristebasis uitgewis is. Volgens die minister van verdediging Magnus Malan het gemechaniseerde troepe ondersteun deur artillerie en elemente van die Suid-Afrikaanse lugmag die basis by Kuvilai uitgewis tydens 'n operasie genaamd Askari.
3-2 Battalion has been officially disbanded. Richard Newton reports that both for present and past members of the unit, it was an emotional occasion.
It was at 3-2 Battalion's base at Pomfret in the Northern Cape that the unit, arguably the most well-known and successful unit to serve South Africa during the Bush War, was officially disbanded. The parade was a sad event for the thousands of present as well as past members of 3-2 Battalion. This much-feared unit came into being in 1975 as a result of the Angolan Civil War, and many of its members came from the FNLA resistance movement. The unit built up its reputation for success in conventional and unconventional operations in Southwest Africa and Southern Angola. With South Africa's withdrawal, the battalion was resettled with their families at Pomfret and deployed in rural areas. Members of this proud unit will now be transferred to other units within the South African Defence Force. According to General Mayron, these units that receive 3-2 members can only benefit from the experience. The base town of Pomfret, which currently houses 6,000 people, will be retained by the Defence Force. Past and present members of the unit, however, feel sold out by what they call the politically motivated destruction of the best unit in the Southern Hemisphere. None feel stronger than the man who founded the unit and trained its first members, Colonel Jan Breitenbach.
I feel we've been betrayed, let down, because the politicians were using this unit's political power. And I don't think it's right, because they bled for this country.
Gister het die staatspresident meneer E.W. de Klerk bekendgemaak dat die omstrede 3-2 bataljon van die Weermag tesame met die eenheid vir Boesmans, 3-1 bataljon en die oud-polisie eenheid Kofoet ontbind gaan word. 3-2 bataljon was allerweer beskou as een van die mees geduchte gevegseenhede nog in die Weermag. Die bydra deur Ewen Engelbrecht.
Die ontbinding van 3-2 bataljon is die finale stap in 'n reeks omstrede gebeure wat begin het met die eenheidse aanwending in die swart woongebiede. Met sy eerste verskyning in die townships het 3-2 bataljon onder skoot gekom van veral die ANC en die PAC, wat gekla het oor die weermagse gebruik van genationaliseerde swart Portugese teen swart Suid-Afrikaners. Die laaste spyker in die doodskus van 3-2 bataljon was die gebeure van 8 April van jaar in Pola Park aan die Oosrand, toe lede van 3-2 na bewering by 'n skietery en verkrachtings betrokke was, waarin een persoon dood en minstens 100 beseer is. In sy ondersoek na die voorval het die Goldstone Kommissie aanbeveel dat 3-2 bataljon se muur aan die swart woongebiede onttrek en nooit weer in 'n binnelandse vredesrol aangewend word nie. Die Pola Park incident het onder meer tot ernstige oor en weer beskuldigings tussen die Weermag en die ANC gelei.
God blame us if some of these cowardly elements hide in the masses in Pola Park, opening fire on us, people getting hurt, now putting the blame on our shoulders.
To our disappointment, we have immediately taken a defense. Defense to say that you had the right to shoot those injured people. They are women. It does not happen to your people.
Waar 3-2 bataljon by sy nuwe basis op Pomfret in die Noord-Kaap wag om te hoor wat sy ontbinding presies gaan behels, hoop die meeste swart Portugese soldate om hulle werk in die Suid-Afrikaanse weermag te behou. Die meeste van hulle ken niks anders as 'n militêre milieu nie. En soos met die oud SAP eenheid Kofoet, is die lede van 3-2 bataljon grootliks van die veiligheidsmagte afhanklik vir hul voortbestaan.
You wouldn't like to go back to Angola?
Well, I should like to go there just to go and visit my family and come back. You see, as I'm now South African citizen, so I would like to stay in this country.
Then in 1989, I get in Weermacht gegaan, tot vandaag. Maar ik voel alright in Weermacht.
I haven't got any planning to go back to Angola, because I haven't got any future. I think I got a few of my family here, my child here, and all of them were born in South Africa. So I haven't got any plan, as I've said, to go back to Angola.
Oor hoe precies 3-2 bataljon ontbind gaan word, is daar nog onduidelikheid. Maar in amptelike kringe word daar van rationalisering en reorganisasie gepraat. Die Weermag sal waarskynlik in die komende dae en weke besluit wat die ontbinding gaan behels. Maar as die SAW hom wil bepaal by die aanbevelings van regter Goldstone, sal hy waarskynlik probeer om die kohesie van 3-2 bataljon geheel en al tot op individuele vlak af te breek.
Jy weet, hulle kom 'n lang pad saam in die Suid-Afrikaanse weermag. Al die lede van 3-2 bataljoen is Suid-Afrikaanse burgers. Hulle is geneutraliseerd. Hulle is professionele soldate, hulle is goed opgelei. Hulle is goed gedissiplineerd, normaalweg gesproke. Hulle is goeie vechters. En 'n mens sal eintlik dom wees om so 'n groep goeie soldate uit jou weermag uit te weer. Ek dink ook nie dat hulle is so goed opgelei dat hulle in verskeie rolle aangewend kan word.
3-2 bataljon se ontbinding is die laaste sien van een van die roemrykste eenhede wat die weermag ooit gehad het en spel die verdwyning van een van die kleurrykste herinneringe van die destydse Bosoorlog in Namibië. Niemand minder nie as die voormalige hoof van die weermag, generaal Jan Geldenhuys, het van 3-2 bataljon gesê, dis die beste gevegseenheid wat daar ooit in die weermag was. En tot vandag toe hang daar in die offisiersmenasie 'n bronsplaat tot dien effek. 3-2 bataljon het in die vroeë jare 70 tot stand gekom, nadat die legendariese kolonel Jan Breitenbach, die broer van die omstrede digter Breiten Breitenbach, die Chipenda-faksie van die destydse FNLA vir die weermag gaan werf het. Dit was tydens die veelbefaamde Angola-offensief van 1975 en 1976. Daarna sou 3-2 by bykans elke groot operasie in die oorlog betrokke wees en het later onder hul vyande as Os Terribis bekend geword. Dis Portugees vir die verskriklikes. Nou word die angel uit die Os Terribis getrek. Die eens gevreesde buffel het sy tyd uitgedien. Maar 3-2 sal nooit vergeet word. Sy merk is in die geheue van 'n hele generasie Suid-Afrikaners gemaak.